you think about the traditional business disciplines, you know, marketing, management, finance, accounting, and so on, what area of academic business most impacted your career path?
Actually, I managed my career to include all disciplines. So I became a head of strategic planning, a financial analyst, a CFO, an operational person, and then a marketing person, a sales person, and then eventually a CEO. And I've been CEO of four companies now.
Now tell me, when you've mentioned you've started companies, you've also tried to salvage companies, but what do you think is common across all those experiences? I mean, if you were, let me give you a challenge. You're starting a coffee shop, okay? Single coffee shop. What are the most important things to pay attention to for that corner coffee shop?
The first thing is the people that you hire. It's absolutely, every business I've run, it's the success of the business has been contingent upon the people you have in the business. Secondly, you have to focus on the clients. You have to do your market research before you start it. You have to focus on the clients, and you have to focus on the quality and the value that you give customers relative to the relative value. So if they pay you $1 for a cup of coffee, that's great if that coffee is perceived to have a value of $2 or $3. Now, if on the other hand, you're going to charge them $2 or $3 and they could get higher quality coffee down the street for $1, you're going to be shortly out of business.
Okay. So, you mentioned the employees first off. Do you, would you pay those employees market, above market? How would you tie their salary to the business?
I've always paid employees above market.
Okay.
And whenever possible, with incentive. I started a steel company one time, and initially I had meetings with the employees to explain what an income statement and a balance sheet was to them, and they had no idea. And over time, I put them on a profit sharing program where I paid 5% of the profits of the company to the employees. And after a few months, they began to ask questions about the income statement, like, what is this expense? What is that expense? Why did you travel to see this steel company? You know, what about your travel expenses? And what was important about that, and I'll give you an example. One of the employees, this was a steel company, incoming coils of steel had a band around them. Well, one of the employees asked me about this banding expense in our income statement, and it was $15,000 a month for banding. And he said, what is that? And I said, well, it's like the banding that we put on shipments that we make going out. He says, but it's the same banding as the shipments we have coming in. I said, yes. He says, we cut those off and throw them away. And I said, that's right. About a week later, I was in the plant, and he said, Richard, come here. And he brought me over, and he showed me. He said, see these bands that I've taken off of these incoming coils? I'm putting them on the outgoing coils. And he put one on, and he says, I just saved $10. And he put another one on, I just saved $3. And he put another one on, and says, so our banding expense very quickly went from $15,000 a month to like $5,000 a month, $10,000 a month. At that time, you could afford two new employees for $10,000 a month. So that's just an indication, sort of the tip of the iceberg. When you get employees knowledgeable about the company, the economics of the company, the expenses of the company, and culturally you get them involved and wanting to make the company successful because they want to make it successful, but also because it has a direct impact on their income, because we were paying 5% of the profits to them, it's amazing what you can get done. That particular company was built under budget, on time, and it became profitable in 6 months.
Now, how do you, what do you credit for that success, that level of success?
The people, absolutely.
The people. Okay.
Getting the right people, getting them engaged appropriately, sharing with them the information about the company and what will drive success, focusing on the quality of what we do, and then focusing on the clients.
Did you locate the company in an area where there was a good labor force?
No, actually, that was coincidental or fortuitous. I located the company by doing a least cost distribution model. That was a steel company. I located it by doing a least cost distribution model of consuming companies that use steel, producing companies that produce steel, and then transportation, rail, highway, and waterway, so that we determine the most economical place to put it.
Yeah, it's interesting. If you have one company and you're doing this analysis, or one location, you can at least satisfy, if not optimize, that formula. But you would hope that company would grow. So if, when you go to a second plant, how do you go about that? Because you have one location that's optimized or close to it. But when you add a second one, it's almost impossible to then optimize that. Do you plan for that second one up front?
Good
and
question.
The third and the fourth?
Good question. I planned for 9.
Okay.
The original business plan called for 9.
Okay.
That company now, 25 years later, has 9 plants in those 9 locations.
Did you plan for the growth in order? So did you know what the second plant, third plant, and so on would be?
I knew the location of the first, second, and third.
Okay.
I didn't know the sequence for the ones after that, but I had the sites located.
And what drove that?
It was, again, the steel consuming companies, the steel producing companies, and the customers or the market.